gender and education. Now, gender and education is a very, very, very vast topic, and we keep hearing a lot about gender these days. But I want you to focus on a couple of things while I'm talking. A, that as I say, gender and education is a vast topic, and when you talk about gender and education, we're not just talking about girl education. There's so many other aspects about gender and education, and while I cannot talk about everything in this talk, we'll just try to touch upon a few other things that that come under the concept of gender and education. The second thing I want you to focus on is that gender and education in itself is not a standalone issue. There are other factors, there are a lot of other factors, a lot of other issues that impact this this area, and the whole idea of the concept of gender and education impacts so many other factors, and that's something we're going to talk about in this talk as well. Now, gender and education did not receive so much priority. Now, okay, so before I begin, I'll just give you an outline of what I'm going to talk about. First, I'll give you an overview of what's gender and education as, what's the situation like in India at the moment when we talk about gender and education. And then I'll talk about a very specific example of the role that language and books play in gender and education. Okay? Okay, so we'll go back a few decades. We'll go back to the mid-80s and early 90s. That was a time when gender and education as a problem that needs to be addressed gained so much importance here. So 90s in India, in specifically for Indian education, was a very important period. That was a time we saw so many initiatives, we saw so many programs happening. And it started with the National Education Policy of India. Now, if you want me to write down any of these program names, just let me know. We have a board here, and I'm writing down on the board. So, it was in the 1980s that we came, that the National Education Policy came out. And this is the first time that gender and education actually, there was a discourse or a dialogue around gender and education that started. Now, this policy was important for gender and education because it started talking about women empowerment. It started talking about how education can play a role in improving the status of women in India, and how education can actually help overcoming all the past injustices or past the prejudices we have had against women education. So that created a new context around which gender and education could be talked about. A few years later, came out the a very important declaration from various UN organizations, UNESCO, UNICEF, World Bank. They started talking about education and how education for all is a very, very important concept. And these two aspects were a turning point for education in India. So education for all and the new education policy, these two were the most important points from where we started seeing a change in the way education was being seen in India. So in the 90s, so that was a time when we came up with so many new initiatives. We saw initiatives at the very town level in the districts, we saw initiatives at the state level, and we saw initiatives at the national level. We saw programs like BPEP, that's a district program for district primary education program. Now, why is a program like this important, and what did this program actually do? Now, the idea behind this program was to get students to school. And now it may seem like getting students to school, I mean, we have schools everywhere, we are going to schools, but the idea of going to school is actually not really, it's not so common in all areas of the country and in so many other countries as well. So the idea of getting students to school itself was a very, very big problem. How do we get students to school? And particularly, how do we get girls students to school? Now we need to understand that there are a lot of factors that pose as a barrier to girls' education in India. From religious factors that say that girls should be at home and should be going out of home alone when they reach a certain age, or some safety concerns, logistical factors like schools being located so far away from home. Also, other personal factors like girls are often, they often have the responsibility to take care of the younger siblings. And it was also realized that just getting the girls to school won't help, because we need to make sure that the people realize that why is it important to get girls to school. So that started a whole range of awareness programs and a whole range of other initiatives, like establishing schools in every 1 kilometer of radius and establishing early childhood centers for the very young kids, so the girls can relieve from that job. The problem was schools are far away, so you bring schools to the localities, or you provide cycles to girls so that they can go to schools themselves. The problem was that the girls had to take care of their younger siblings, so you establish an early childhood center in schools or in villages. The problem was that the parents were not very willing to send their girls to school because the schools were not preparing them for to be a good wife or to be a mother. Then you deal with mothers and you bring the mothers to school, you bring the parents to school and talk to them and tell them that education is very important and it does more than prepare a child for a career, it prepares them for a life. So such varied programs were initiated to ensure that girls' education is gaining more importance. So here I wanted to think about how each and every problem has to be individually tackled. You realize that there are several barriers to girls' education. You pick each one of them up and you think about how these can be overcome. And that's what these individual initiatives and programs were trying to do. Now, these programs were successful in getting students to school, and especially girls to school, and we suddenly saw such significant improvement in enrollment rates. The number of students going to school, especially the number of girls going to school. But the problem remains that there was a lot of absenteeism, girls were not coming to school. There was a high rate of dropout. Students were leaving schools, especially the girls were leaving school, especially after grade 8, mostly because that was, until grade 8, education in India is free. So after that, girls would often leave school. The number of girls in higher education was even lower. So what should we do now? While there are a lot of programs that have been initiated, even in the recent time, for example, a very recent campaign about Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao Andolan. So that's basically talking about how girls should be sent to school, how education can help in their come back to how gender plays a role in language. And we talk about, I'll give you an example of a very recent study that I read. And the study was conducted by IBM, what IBM did was they picked up the books that have received awards in the past 50 years, and they looked at gender roles of the characters, of the main characters in those books. Interestingly, they found out that all the male characters usually have adjectives defining them as brave, as intelligent, as handsome, as strong. All the female characters had adjectives defining them as very pretty, as beautiful, as soft-spoken, as very kind. So do you see the difference? Do you see the difference in how a male character is defined and how a female character is defined? Usually the adjectives assigned to male characters were considered to be very masculine characteristics. All the characteristics the adjectives used to define the female characters were what we considered to be very soft adjectives, very soft characteristics. Similarly, the use of language, the use of pronouns. We do not have any gender-neutral pronouns in English, for example. As I was talking, that every word that gets assigned a gender. Now, this becomes a problem in, let's say, a classroom. 2 years ago, I was in a classroom in Maharashtra for some week work, and the teacher there was giving us an overview of the school, was showing us around, and he kept mentioning that the boys here do very well. The boys are doing very well in the studies. The boys are very active. They engage in a lot of games and they engage in a lot of activities. My colleague and I thought that it was a boys' department. And we actually asked the teacher that we thought it's a co-ed school. Is this a boys' school? And he said, no, it's a co-ed school. Now, what happens is that we do not usually have a gender neutral word for kids. And in Hindi, we commonly use words like boys or ladke to define all children. Now, what happens when we use words like these, words that are not gender neutral? A, we are eliminating a whole community of people. We are excluding a whole community of people. When in this classroom of, let's say, 25 girls and 25 boys, we call everybody boys. We are just eliminating all the 25 girls from that community. Secondly, we are limiting their choices and we're giving them identities and limiting what they can do. For example, when I say a chairman, or I say when you use words like these, where we have the word man at the end of them, immediately the image that comes to our mind is that of a man. When we think of, let's say, the bank being headed by a chairman, we would never imagine a woman being the head of the bank. The image that these kinds of words perpetuate are very gender specific, and that's why they perpetuate certain kinds of gender roles. Limiting the choice, limiting the options that people can have, because these words carry a lot of social meaning and they carry a lot of weightage and assign a lot of social meaning to the kinds of roles that can be taken up by people. And that's why it becomes a problem when we use very gender-specific words like chairman. And coming back to education and how this relates to education and why I actually talked about this, when we talk about occupations and we use very gender-specific terms, terms that either relate to a male or to a female, we are telling the children that it's okay to be a chairman when you are a boy, but maybe it's not okay to be a chairman when you're a woman. Or when we say that I want each and every child to be silent, or I want each and every child to follow the rules, who doesn't follow, the person, the child who doesn't follow a rule, he will be punished. Immediately all the girls are out of it. You know, it's not my problem. Now, this is not just a problem for girls, it becomes a problem for all the students, whether a girl or a boy, because you are assigning these gender roles not just to girls, but to boys as well. So it's important that teachers, students, all of us make a concerted effort to use a more gender-neutral language. I think I'll... Yeah. Yeah.
Things that we are debating in America and in Europe and all over the world. Like the same kinds of questions are coming in education here and there, and so that's pretty interesting. So thanks. Awesome. Well, if we have more time for questions, come back. Now, I'm going to let Grandma introduce herself because I want to make sure I give her as much time as I can.
Basic things to healthcare, which is like if somebody is not eating well, then they are not going to do very well in terms of their health. One of the things I realized when I went around trying to look for countries which are doing very well in healthcare and finding out why they do so well in healthcare, I thought, oh, this country is too small. This country is an example for India. What I realized is there is going to be no country which is going to be around the size of India. You are actually the exception, and everybody else is the rule. So finding somebody that size, there's only China. So a lot of these countries which are doing very well, the models are difficult to replicate here because of size. But having said that, each country, each state in India is like a little country because it has its own language, it has its own culture. It's like a little mini Europe where there are so many countries with so many different languages. So if things can work in several countries in Europe, which have got very good health indicators, why doesn't that happen in a place like India? And why don't these individual states do well? So there are some states in India which do well. There are some states which do almost as well as one of the European countries. So can anybody guess which are those states? Yeah, Kerala. Yeah, Kerala. Another one which is fast catching up is Himachal Pradesh. There is one which is Tamil Nadu. And one of the things you will find common for all these states is that there is a lot of emphasis within the governments of those states on healthcare. And there is a lot of emphasis on spending enough for healthcare. Because you're not going to get healthcare without there being some kind of commitment, just being able to spend for that kind of care that you need. So one of the things that you see in India is barely about 1.2% of the GDP of the country is spent on healthcare. 1.2%, and the average in the world is 6%. So India is in the company of countries like Burundi and Congo and countries in sub-Saharan Africa which are concerned with really badly off. Why? Also because those countries are suffering from civil conflict, from war, from all kinds of unrest. India has no such excuse. There is no civil conflict happening here. There is no war happening here, and it's still this country is 1.2%. And if you only spend that kind of money, that's the kind of result you will also get. Having said that, why is it that not just India, but the whole world is worried about rising healthcare cost? Cost is like a big issue now all over the world. It's not just in India, but in Europe, in US. In fact, there is one thing that is common both US and to India. The largest number of bankruptcies in the US happen because of healthcare costs, because people cannot afford healthcare. So people end up paying for healthcare in the US and going bankrupt. And in India, the second most common reason for people going completely broke and even being pushed below the poverty line is healthcare costs. People have to borrow, people have to sell their land, their assets to pay for healthcare. So this is something that both countries have. What's the other thing that's common? A hugely privatized healthcare system where it's all dominated by for-profit system, where healthcare is like a commodity which can be sold and you can buy it if you have the money. If you don't have the money, you buy it. You don't get healthcare. So that's a system that's common to both US and to India. Now, why is healthcare not like a car, not like a branded shoe? Can anybody tell me why? Yeah, but why can't they have a right to a good transport? Yes, they can also go by a car. Any reason why? Yeah? Yeah, all of those are true, you know. I mean, healthcare will. But let's talk about even illness, for example, not just dying, but even if you are just having illness, if you're just ill. The difference, the main difference between healthcare and anything else you buy is that this, you don't really have a choice. Like, if I cannot afford a car, if I cannot afford something, any of the material things that I have, I might be able to say, maybe not a car this year, maybe next year. Or I can say, not as car, I'll go can't do that. In a lot of cases, you can't do that. So you're vulnerable, you cannot wait, you're in distress, so you can't even think straight when you're in pain. So for all these reasons, you cannot compare healthcare with any commodity. In fact, it's a crime that it's considered to be a commodity that is available only to people who can pay. Ideally, healthcare, like justice, like law and order, should be available to you completely free of cost. Do you ever pay to have a case registered when you go to the police station? Does anybody? No, you don't. Do you need to pay a judge so that you can get your case heard? No. Why? I mean, judges also cost money. The entire legal system costs you money. The courts have to be built. People have to be paid their salaries, but you don't find a single country saying that this is getting too expensive, so I'm going to privatize the whole thing. Let's make it a for-profit system. Those who can afford it can come and pay for justice. We don't accept that. In the same way, it should not be acceptable that people cannot get health care when they are sick. But again, that's something that is common to India and the US. We think it is perfectly okay in India as well as in the US to say, if you don't have the money, you don't get health care. Or in the US, I don't know if you guys have read about it, many prisons are privatized. If prisons are privatized, then the prison which is running for profit feels that they need to fill it up with people. Otherwise, how would they make the money? So then that leads to corruption. So there are some things which maybe are not the best for private companies. And I would argue that healthcare is one of those. And when you talk about the cost of healthcare, we also need to go into why is it that these costs are going up? Again, both India and US have the same problem. The cost of hospitalized healthcare is also going up. Because all the focus and all the place where the money is being spent in both the countries is on what is called curative medicine. So you're always thinking of a cure after you've fallen ill. You're not placing enough emphasis on preventing people from falling ill. So there is also policies you can put in place to make sure that people don't fall ill. What would be an example of preventive healthcare? Can you give me an example? Yeah?
Vaccines.
Yeah, vaccines. That's still an intervention. Anything else that you can think of? What is preventive healthcare? So I'll go back to the first speaker who talked about living conditions. That's preventive healthcare. If you have good house, you have clean drinking water, that's preventive healthcare. You're taking care of a whole lot of diseases. If you have some of the basics taken care of, you get the basics right. I'll give you an example of, this is my favorite example because I was so blown away by that. I was in Germany, in Hamburg, and I was visiting the medical museum over there. And one of the exhibits said that Germany had in Hamburg had a major outbreak of cholera in the 1890s. And thousands of people died because of cholera. Now, cholera is spread through bad water. So what happened was when thousands of people died, Hamburg, for the first time, realized that this is happening because a neighboring town, which had white water and clean drinking water, they didn't have so many deaths. That's when they realized the importance, and they decided, okay, so we are going to do something about what are the street supply for people. They reformed the entire water supply system, and they reformed the entire housing. The miracle is, since 1892, now we're talking about more than 100 years back, there hasn't been a single case of cholera in Hamburg. Not a single case. And we are talking about a time when no antibiotics existed. There were no medicines. And still they managed to stop the disease in its tracks by just providing clean drinking water and demolishing all the slums and giving good living conditions by building houses for people. Now those are the things which we talk about when we talk about preventive healthcare. So instead of spending hundreds of rupees or thousands of dollars on treating the person after the person has got cholera, enough emphasis on preventive healthcare. All the emphasis is on the very highly expensive curative healthcare. And curative healthcare is important because no matter how many factors you take care of, there are some people going to fall ill, and you do want those people to have access to good healthcare. So you do want curative healthcare. But you also want to make sure that your people are not falling ill all the time. For example, obesity is a huge problem in the US. It's a growing problem in India. In India, we have a combination of it. So we have one bunch of people who are starving and who have malnutrition issues, undernutrition, and you have another bunch, which is the urban kids, who are all becoming obese. And what's the result of obese? One of the things is diabetes. India is called the diabetes capital of the world. US has a huge problem with diabetes. Again, why is that a problem? Because the food companies there are not regulated enough. They're allowed to advertise to children. Now, this is something which a lot of countries are looking at, that they should be not allowed to advertise to children. Like, what would be the things which are advertised to children by food companies? Yeah?
McDonald's,
yes. Something else? Yeah? Uh-huh, yeah. Cola. Cola is the worst. Now, yes?
1 minute.
So, cola is another one, and very sugar high cereals and stuff are the other things which are happening towards children. So, there are lots of preventive stuff we can do, but which doesn't get done. We are not talking about a world which is totally devoid of all the sneaky pleasures of a cola once in a while or very sweet things, but we are talking about an overdose of these things. If these things don't get taken care of, we're going to see an increasingly sick world, and a world where we're going to be spending a lot of money on just keeping people healthy, or we're going to watch more and more people who are not able to afford healthcare just suffering because they can't reach the care that they need. I think I'll stop there and let you guys ask questions.
Okay, two questions, guys. Give us everybody's thinking themselves together for lunch.
Yes.
I mean, they want to go have a healthy lunch.
Yes.
I just want to say that, one of the big ideas I hope people are taking away is that if you start studying the Yamuna River, it's going to relate to something like healthcare. Or if you're thinking about why it is that there's a line of people in front of a government hospital, well, there's a lot of reasons for that, but one of them might be that we haven't cleaned the Yamuna River, right? And we still have dirt. So, like, this is really all like this. It's connected, right? So that's a really big idea. And the idea here isn't that you're going to come away with a million facts, but the idea is that you're thinking about what you might want to investigate. And there are three